amongst the organizers. My name is Jonathan Kaina, and I'm a PhD student of the Cases Research Group at UPF in Barcelona. The issue we are going to discuss in this presentation is the use of spatially statistical methods in the context of anthropogenic soil information. The method discussed will be applied to an ethnoarchaeological case of study. The general objective of this research area is to study the spatial human behavior through the chemical composition of soils. As a specific objectives, we can distinguish between two kinds of problems. First problem, which is a prospection problem related with land use management, and which can be considered as some sort of engineering problem. And the other is the problem of identifying the activity areas in an intra-site scale, which is more connected with the general objective. The baseline assumption here is that specific activity areas left characteristical chemical imprints in soils. However, the truth is that we have a limited understanding of the links between the chemical composition of soils and the archaeological problems, resulting in a few peer-reviewed publications and projects. This is part in part because of the great challenge that we are facing. For instance, the difficulties in determining the site-specific geogenic baseline. And also to understand and identify the specific taphonomical or alterations that are affecting the soil formation. The data we are, that we can use for this kind of studies came from a regular or semi-regular sampling called re-iation that can be carried out according to different strategies, depending on the questions that will be that we want to be addressing. In the other hand, the data is essentially multivariate data and comes from laboratory analysis. In fact, the data that I'm going to present here comes from an archaeological case of study, which is composed by a house and its courtyard, situated in Jandara, India. The idea here is to link the ethnographical information with this chemical with the chemical patterns that we can identify in the soil chemistry. In fact, the use of ethnoarchaeological data for this kind of problem has been already published in some studies, especially in Central and South America, but rarely in other parts of the planet. The methodology used in most of these studies consist in common multivariate techniques for the archaeologists, such as unsupervised learning or clustering or dimensionality reduction. In fact, PCA, or principal components analysis, is a common technique used in many fields, such as soil science or ecology, and tries to capture the maximum variability possible of the data in a few components through the decomposition of the matrix of variance covariance. As we can see in both results, we can identify a characteristic pattern in the middle of the area, which corresponds to the house. And if as we can see in the PCA space, it seems to be a hyperplane of separability that distinguishes the house and the courtyard. This hyperplane is a concept that derived from machine learning, which corresponds to to a clear boundary of separability. In fact, characteristic pattern that we found in the house is actually related to the floor composition, which is made with dung and other local materials, and obviously shows a different pattern. So that, in fact, what we are interested in is to study the other variations that we can see in the area, including the ones that we can identify in the house itself. However, the previous methodology did not take into account the spatial nature of data. Indeed, as I guess you know, chemical variables show certain degree of autocorrelation. And this is what geostatistics deal with, trying to model the spatial behavior of the variables through the variogram. In fact, despite the ultimate objective of the statistics is to obtain accurate predictions or interpolations of the data, we can use also the model to explore some other questions or even to make some inferences. For example, explore the directionality or anisotropy, or to obtain prediction uncertainty in order to formally test hypotheses, or even to optimally design the sampling. In fact, geostatistics provides a powerful tool for the multivariate data, which is called the factorial kriging. The idea is to fit the variograms and cross variograms simultaneously to obtain what is called the correlationalization matrix, which can be used in further analysis instead of the classical variance or covariance matrix. But the value of this method is in fact that it allows us to identify physical processes that are operating at different spatial scales, and then decompose each one of these physical processes individually. Here in the bottom, we can see the global regionalized factor, the two first global regionalized factors, which in fact do not change drastically from the simple interpolation of a PCA analysis, which is apparently unsatisfactory considering the efforts in fitting the model. However, as I said previously, we can try to individualize the different spatial structures and then plot it individually. Here, in this case of a study, we have identified two different variogram models. One with a spherical shape and a range of 6 meters, and the other with a exponential shape and a large range, about 24 meters. As you can see, in this short range model, there is it is capturing the local variation with a small values in the courtyard and the characteristic pattern in the house. Moreover, the third component is capturing some interesting points, such as this one that is actually related with a charcoal stain area. In the other hand, the exponential model seems to show well-defined different areas of this space. For instance, here, animal and haystack areas, in cold colors, the storage and burn areas, and in green, the more intensive human activity. However, the the methods that have been discussed for now can be considered just as exploratory methods. And in fact, we have other informations both in the archaeological and in the archaeological context. In our case, obviously, the interviews and direct observations. But in the case of archaeology, we can use also the artifact distributions or the distance to the structures as a working hypothesis. The idea here is to try to model formally the signal using some exploratory variables, trying to identify some patterns and understand the affectations. One of the most trendy approaches is try to apply a predictive model. For instance, logistic regression to predict categorical variables, or linear discriminant analysis, which is more related to dimensionality reduction. However, we are facing some related problems, such as the uncertainty about the likelihood function, especially problematic for bias fragments, or the risk of overfit the data. But we can still, using stepwise variable selection to understand which one is more important, or explore the working hypothesis that we have to model these kind of things. An alternative is to use the redundancy analysis to constrain the multivariate ordination by means of explicitly model the variance with the explanatory variables, thus obtaining new components that contain both the deterministic part and the residuals. As you can see in the bottom, the first redundancy factor is not so different from the PCA that we have obtained with factorial cleaning, which is not bad. But the second redundancy factor tells another totally different story, with this point related to the charcoal area, but suggesting that something similar is happening in the other part of the courtyard. But we have still problems with these points there that may represent in our model animal or high stack areas. So following the previous concept, we can try to exploit the concept of universal model of variation, which is actually what does the regression cleaning. The point here is to concentrate in the second part of the equation, which corresponds to the spatially correlated random component, and then try to link that with some possible errors that can be affecting our analysis, such as labeling, ambiguous surface space, geogenic variation, taphonomic, or anthropic spatial variations. In this sense, we can plot individually these errors, or even more, we can perform a PCA over these residuals, trying to link them with the kinds of errors that we are thinking about. As you can see, the first and second principal components of the residuals seems to be quite related to labeling errors or ambiguous surface space. But the third component, as we can see, is more related with a large scale affectations that can be linked with different pedagogical processes that are taking place because of the human management of the space. And it's all. I don't think.